Hey again, and once again, some of the guests are the intro and the grand. What are we doing here? But this is our last show of April because it's such a special. So I'm going to loan Greg out to a farm market next week.
Yeah.
So yeah, if you want to go see him, we'll do that. But this is actually a very special show. It's been a crazy April with the eclipse and all the other stuff. But I'm very proud to have these guests. But first, we have a guest host, co-host, Stevie T.
Yeah, man.
Hello.
Not the guy who serves the plates, the other guy.
Oh, I'm the other Stevie
and
T.
And very own Greg. And if you'd like to introduce our guests, I'll give you the honor.
Well, we have the three members of the great band, the Rustix, back from late 60s, early 70s, I believe. And we have Dave Colon.
Yes.
And Vince Strenk and Chuck Brucato.
That's good. When we have more than, like, two members, I can't remember the names, so I have you do it. But I've heard a lot, like, of your beginnings. It's almost like a movie beginning, how the Rustix began. Like, you were singing, and somebody saw you, like, hey, you guys want to come to the band?
Yeah, so somebody tell us how the band started. Let's start at the beginning.
Go ahead, Chuck.
Go ahead, Chuck.
Chuck. This is your deal.
I was in the service with Al Gallich, and we said we'd get together when he got out. He had a year ahead of me, and I said, well, I'll never see him again. But he did come to Rochester, and Al and I and two other guys started singing just for fun. Instead of golfing or bowling, we enjoyed two or three nights a week of just singing. And then one night after we got done, we stopped at a bar for a beer, and just the bartender was there, and I was singing in a booth. Guy walked in, and he said, you guys sound good. Well, I'm just opening a club in Ontario, way out in Ontario.
Right.
So why don't you come on Friday night and sing for, I don't know, $10 and beer or something like that.
It's like back when it was easy to get gigs.
So we looked at each other, said, okay. I said, but we don't have a band. He says, can you get one? I said, well, I knew Bob DeAndrea and Bobby Blandino at the time, and another bass player, which I'm sorry, I forgot his name. And we looked at each other and said, sure. And then we said, well, we don't have any equipment. And he says, well, what do you need? I says, I didn't know. It was like the early 60s. I said, I don't know, a couple $100. Yeah. And he goes, one, two, lays $200 down. He says, I'll see you next Friday. Walks out the door.
Wow.
And so off you went to where? Benson's Music or something?
Is this for real? So we looked at each other and I said, well, instead of singing at Al's house, we'll go out there and sing.
Yeah.
That was it. So I got two 10-inch speakers from my basement, in my mother's basement, a 50-watt Bogan amplifier, and two of the cheapest mics I could find.
Wow. Bogan.
And that started the whole thing.
It got started. Uh-huh. So how did the band get its name?
One of the singers lived on Rustix Street.
One of the singers? Was that you, Chuck?
It was a friend of mine called Jack Pecora.
Also, somebody else.
But that's how bands get named. If you go in Pittsburgh here, some of my friends, you'll see a building that says Wilkes Singing Crump. Yeah. One of my friends saw it, named their band after Tommy Francis.
That's a good idea. Yeah. We just changed the C to an X. Okay. How clever.
Rustix.
I'm bothering.
Right.
It works. Like, that's very 60s way out there, dude. That's like very 60s way out.
Taking chances.
But what I enjoy hearing that story, too, though, is you go back, but some people just cared about music, and they didn't care about anything. They would hear people singing. It's like it seemed like in the 60s there was more that, like, some of the record companies, Dylan or Quicksilver, their stuff tanked. They would be tossed now, but they gave them the chance, and they just heard you sing, and they're like, hey, this is pretty cool, let's have them play.
Yeah,
right.
This was like for a gong show type thing.
Yeah. We love singing. Then we played in that form for I don't know, a few months, and then one thing led to another. It's hard to remember. I remember playing at this place in Maplewood. Were you in the band then?
No.
That was strange.
Is that on West Ridge?
Yeah, West Ridge.
I played there. I played there once. They had go-go girls in cages.
It was crazy. And that was sort of like the era where between when bands were like dressed the same and had a little act going.
Right.
So I had Bob DeAndrea wear a wig and we sang "I Got You, Babe." We had
shtick.
Yeah, we had I said, let's have a mitt and a glove and we'll play catch while somebody So after we got done, the guy says, look, you guys sound good, but when you come back next week, leave the gloves and the hat and the wigs home. Just sing.
Just
and play.
So let me ask you this,
that's
then.
That's kind of cool.
You know, with the two singers, did you go in with the idea of kind of following in the footsteps of the Righteous Brothers?
Not really.
No?
No. I still remember distinctly we were over at Al's house, and the two other guys didn't show up, showed up late. And we were singing, Don't Let the Sun Catch You Crying.
Okay.
Al and I were singing it.
Okay.
And we looked at each other and said, oh, my God, what a sound. Because he had, like, a lower voice
and
I had the higher
right,
voice.
Yeah.
And we'd been singing so long in the service that we're just really tight.
Okay.
But I want to move on now
to
these guys.
Yeah.
We had different people come in and out of the band. And then we finally had, I think, David first.
Yeah. Yeah, I was playing with the Invictus at the Wire City Inn, and the Rustix followed us. And Bobby Brandino left the group for service or something.
Right, he wanted to play jazz.
And Chuck came up to me and asked me if I wanted to play drums with the Rustix. And I said, whoa, you know, because I was playing with Herbie, and
right.
he's a totally different character than these guys.
Right?
Sure.
Right.
And the bands, it was just totally different sound. And I thought it was a really, really big challenge because these guys were playing the kind of music I wanted to play. Then I was through with the screaming and the Papa, Farmer John and Louie Louie and all that
right,
stuff.
Right, right.
So these guys were doing classy stuff. And I said, wow, this is my chance to
a little
get
more
it.
Me,
I don't know why he thought I could match Bobby Blandino, but he did. He gave me that break, and I loved it. I loved playing, and it was hard because these guys were hard on me because they had to be. You know, they were professionals,
right.
And I became a much, much better drummer with these guys, you know, and I loved playing with the group for as long as I did.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, I remember when I was in high school, because I'm probably a couple of years younger than you guys, but not too much, but I mean, you were the big deal. You were
absolutely
the professional band. I mean,
wow.
You know, you guys had, like, what they call now a residency, but you were at the club all the time on Gould Street.
On Gould Street, yeah.
I mean, I never got to go there, see, because I was too young. I was, like, 16 when everybody else was going there.
Well, Greg and I are the same age. Andy as well. Andy's in the control room listening to all of this. Hi, Andy.
You.
So you guys were the band that we looked up to, that we went to see.
For sure.
The teen dances. Some of the clubs when they opened it up for the, you know, the high school kids at the club, actually, and the high schools. So you guys were one of the bands that we looked up to, most definitely.
You paved the way. I mean, you showed us kind of how to do it. You know?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Long before we got to know each other. It really is. And I wanted to go back and say I wanted to thank you guys for being here today. It truly is an honor and a pleasure to be in your company. Seriously.
Thank you.
Yeah, it really is. It's one of our special shows.
Another thing is it's just a series of coincidences that made this band work. You know, like Al moving back here. And then that guy coming out of the woodwork with $200.
Right,
And then... I think a big, well, first of all, let's talk about Vin, when Vinny came in. And I'll start.
What was the band you were with before that? This?
I was with the Custard Cluster.
The Custard Cluster.
Custard Cluster. Yeah, we were playing at the VI. That was probably about my sixth or seventh band that I had been in.
Yeah.
And I know that's probably where you guys saw me.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And then I got a call one time, and they said, hey, you know... we're looking for an organist. And I went, young little puppy that I was, 17 or 18 years old. I think I might have been 17 at the time.
No, you were.
Yeah, I was young, man.
You were the fourth organist that we tried, by the way.
And then
I
remember the first first job that I had was at the 414 Club with you guys.
Right. That was fun.
East Ridge Road, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
And we were on that little stage, and the only thing that was happening is I was forgetting, you know, some of the chords, and the Andrew would turn around and go, gee, gee.
We still do that today.
Well, that's because you're older now.
Change!
I just forget.
Well, I guess, like, when Ian McLaughlin was playing with Dylan... He said, one of the band members came and said, don't get really nervous if Bob stares at you during the show. And he's, he sees Bob Dylan staring at him. He wonders why. And afterwards he finds out Bob's nearsighted. And he can't, he's trying to watch him to see what he's playing to go with him.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, that's funny.
So yeah. Then after that, let's see. Now these guys got in the band, and Billy Friel used to own the Varsity Club. Remember that?
Right.
Oh, yeah. And I used to go in there and torture him about three nights a week. We got to get our band in here. So I think we started on a Tuesday night for no money, and then on Wednesday. Then the big night was a Friday. Oh, boy. Because that was the hottest club.
Right,
it was.
Yeah, it was built specifically for that kind of music of that era. So that's when, like, pretty much the full band was there. And then we had Ronnie join the band from the house. And that was basically the band. Now, what really kicked us off is we were playing there. We were all working. We had, some of us had families. And David had a connection, and this is what really broke us loose. It was David. He had a connection in Lake George.
Right, yeah.
And he,
got us an audition there
and got us 2 months of steady work.
Mm-hmm.
And we looked at each other and said, well, this is it. We got to quit our jobs and go for it.
Really?
Yeah.
No kidding.
And that's what really did it.
Huh. Uh-huh.
And we went down and we played 2 months straight. Six sets a night,
half hour on, half hour off
for 2 months. So when we got back, we were very, very tired.
I just moved on from there.
But that was a big move that David came up with there.
Well done, David.
We went back there twice, the second year too.
Yeah.
We were drawing like crazy. Man.
Right, we did well there.
Did you ever play like the bowling alleys that was big at the time?
Brighton Bowl was big. Brighton Bowl, they had a lot of bands.
We used to pack that place. Yeah.
I remember seeing the Showstoppers there, I think.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. 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 Yeah, that was, they had a lot of nice.
Back when they had Bandmaster Bottoms for a PA.
Yeah.
Then the owner of Brighton Bowl built the club, Dave.
Oh, yeah.
Goldman. Right. Just for the Rustix. It's incredible.
I forgot about one thing. When we first auditioned in Lake George, Al and I had this brainstorm that we're going to play saxes. I played for about 6 months. Al played for about a month. And we sound like two ducks. But I thought, wouldn't that be cool? You know, two frontmen playing saxes. We sucked. So we brought them down to the Lake George, I remember.
And
they just stood on the stage for a whole month, spit in there at people throwing cups.
For money.
And Charlie, whatever his name, never said anything about playing the horn.
Charlie Wade.
That's funny.
Yeah.
I could have played the kazoo. That would have been good. Now, but I'm hearing more from bands about residencies and all this, and I think one thing it does, that's how the Beatles came together in Hamburg. Because you're playing so much, and just, it's such a shared experience because you're tired, you have to go on, you have to give your best. It really brings you together as a group.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
And plus, you know, your sound's going to be the same every night, so you're not adjusting every night. I mean, you make adjustments for maybe less crowd, more crowd, but other than that, you can depend on the acoustics, and you've got your stuff figured out, and it's more consistent.
Yeah. Right. I think that's what the club was for us. Club, I mean, we played there, what, 3 years probably?
A long time.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we'd go to Motown Record or do some high school stuff, but we always came back there, and that was a nice Monday through Thursday in Detroit.
Wow.
Yeah.
And then Friday back here to play.
Mm. Yeah, what was the Detroit connection? How'd that happen?
We started at Cadet Records, actually. We did When I Get Home there.
Yeah.
I don't know why that didn't go through. That guy, I think that guy would have captured our
sound. He was good.
And then, I guess through Ferdy, we got a connection, or maybe from Cadet.
Ferdinand Jay, right?
Yeah.
So
we had Dean Taylor.
Our Dean Taylor.
And Barry Cordy's sister came down to hear us.
Wow. Okay. He just died.
Mm. But, what was the initial connection to get those guys? That's how you knew them?
It was probably Ferdy made a connection through Cadet or whatever.
A phone call.
Yeah, a phone call.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So,
and they sent somebody from Motown to listen to us.
Yeah, Gene Taylor and Barry Gordy's sister. I forgot her name.
Isn't that when we went to New York City and
Mrs.
played
Gordy
at that club?
Ungano's.
They weren't there then.
Who was there for that one? Do you remember?
Yeah, I know. The kid from the Rascals, Gene Cornish.
Gene, okay.
Which I thought was very cool because they were on top then. But he's a friend of Bobby DeAndrea's, and he came down to see us. And we got a good review from that place.
Yeah, we did.
So anyway, Dean Taylor and and Barry Gordy's sister came down to hear us. And it happened to be one night at the club when it was mobbed, and somebody gave us a bomb scare.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, there were a couple of those going on. Do you remember that? Yeah.
Even back then, we had bomb scares.
Yeah, and I thought it was in my own sick way, I thought it was kind of cool. You know, we're so popular that they're throwing bomb scares.
Yeah, somebody wants to kill us. We're really popular.
From the Dean Taylor and the Motown people.
All the Motown people, yes.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Get out of town.
So we all bailed out of there, came back in and sang, and Dean stood with us for a while.
Yeah.
And gave us some ropes and blah, blah, blah. And then from there, we went to Motown and started recording.
Oh, cool.
Now, he produced the first album, the Bedlam album.
Yes,
now,
right.
He really didn't do the band. I don't know how you guys feel about it, but he really didn't capture
your authentic
sound, because he added a lot of horns and some strings. The strings weren't bad on...
Free Again.
You know, that's an incredible tune.
Yeah.
Listening to it today, and I've listened to that album, Bedlam, all these years. In fact, I recorded it on a cassette for a long time and listened to it in my car, in some of my older cars.
Was that Al on that one, or was that you?
That was Al with a deeper voice,
yeah. Right. But Ardeen Taylor added a lot of horns.
Right.
So how did you compromise, or when you played a live gig, you know, on the record it had the horns.
Mm-hmm.
How did you guys atone for that and make up for it?
Keyboards.
It was hard. I said, did not accept it. I personally did not accept it.
Yeah.
But, you know, some of us in the group wanted a bigger sound and wanted to be exposed to that bigger deal.
Okay.
And we tried it. But you're right. It changed our sound. It wasn't us. It was something us plus Motown.
It was probably too smooth.
I didn't realize we were going to have that much orchestration.
Yeah, I didn't. They really, really overdid it, like you said. Yeah.
I do like it, though. I mean, listening to it and looking back and listening to it still through all these years, to me, I love the songs on that album, I have to say. Not because I know you guys now after all these years. We've all become friends. But I've been listening to that album since day one.
It created a problem with us when we were doing those things live, you know, but we could not reproduce all
you
those.
You couldn't reproduce it unless...
Oh, no way. We didn't have all the technology that we have today.
Right.
Unless you hired
a horn section. Right. Yeah. Which you already had six people, so,
so
things were cut kind of
thin. Remember,
we used to fake it.
We tried to do horns with vocals and stuff like, ba-ba-da, you know?
Oh, right. What was the other thing I was going to say? There was a... I can't remember now. What made me feel good about that, and then the second album, which was kind of okay, was that I read that the Supremes and the Temptations, they used to call them the no-hit wonders.
Yes.
They put out
in the very beginning,
nine or ten records, and they all flopped.
They all flopped. The Supremes especially, yes.
If we could have stayed a little bit longer.
Because
we were just starting. I mean, we're only young kids.
Right.
You know, we're in the biggest studio in the world,
sure.
Greatest studio in the world. We were, whatever they told us to do, we did, right?
Yeah,
basically.
Yeah.
And I think if we could have just stayed a little longer, refined our sound. And I always tried to get Norman Whitfield. I don't know if you guys know Norman Whitfield.
Sure, sure.
I'd go up to him and say, Norman, will you please just cut one song out, just one song. I mean, he had every, you know, he had the top ten.
Right, he was a big producer, right?
Yeah.
And he'd look at me and just, like, one time he says, this is verbatim, I said, Norman, will you please just cut one song out, right? He goes, you realize there's 350 million people in this country and you can't get your, please 700,000 of them and get yourself a hit record. You ought to be ashamed of yourself. there he is, the king of pop records telling me, it's real easy.
Yeah, the harsh realities of the business.
Yeah. He went on to work with the Rare Earth Band, who took the same name as the record company, Rare Earth.
Right. And, we played with them on that.
Yeah, yeah. It was a good band, too.
Oh, great. Yeah. Well, Norman was, he did oh my God, the number, the hits that that guy, him and his partner.
Okay, yeah. This, Temptations, he worked with all the Motown bands, yeah. Obviously.
What was the second record name?
That was Come On People, was the second LP. Yeah.
Which was the one that was the rounded...
That was Bedlam.
That was Bedlam.
See, when that album came out, they did a show at called Rooster in Detroit, and there were several acts there from Motown also performing with us, and every star that you can name from Motown was out in the audience.
Wow.
And we played along with Red Earth.
That was no pressure,
though. Biggest, that was the biggest night for me of the whole scene with Motown when we played at that club. Wasn't that fabulous? Right against the background was the lake. It was just beautiful. You know, we were just sitting in front of these windows and all these famous people in front of us. It was just, you couldn't match that, you know?
Yeah. That was going to be one of my questions. What was one of your favorite memories?
That was yours. Tale, yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Smokey Robinson came off and shook our hand. Oh, wow. One memory I have, I got to tell you this
one.
Gay.
Yeah.
We were supposed to be in the studio at, say, 7 o'clock or something. So we're at 7, 7:15, 7:30. It's 4 to 8. I'm like, what the hell, man? Yeah. And Marvin Gaye walks out, and he comes up there, and he shakes my hand. I'm sorry, man. Sorry, I had to go overtime. And I'm like, Marvin, don't ever let that happen.
Don't ever do it. Don't ever do it again.
Don't ever let that happen. No, I didn't say that. But I thought that was so cool of him. I mean, he could have just walked by and said,
that's a class act right there.
He was a class act.
How about you, Vince? How about you? Got any special memory of a show?
I have to tell you that I probably was the most nervous in Nashville when we played the Nashville Pop Festival.
No kidding. Yeah. Oh, my God.
So many people out in front. I think they estimated, 35,000
at least 50 bands, right?
Yeah. and of course, we played, and then who comes on right after us?
Underground Railroad.
No, Grand Funk.
Grand Funk Railroad. Before they were big.
Yeah, it was really that was a wild time for me.
Was the Atlanta Pop Festival or Nashville?
No, Nashville.
But I know they did the Atlanta one too. Wow, they had a Nashville one too.
Yeah, we had been in Mississippi for the big storm, and we played there, and then we went up to.
Yeah, it was big. There was Bob Hope was the MC.
Wow.
Gold Digger, Percy Sledge. That one. This is like Forrest Gump or something. Because who was that governor that refused to let the kids in?
George Wallace.
Governor Wallace was there.
Yeah.
And we were on TV. It was a big deal. And then the president calls Bob Hope. I said, I remember we had our first limousine ride through Jackson, Mississippi with a police escort. Remember
that? Was for Camille.
If our friends could see us now.
I tried to tell myself everybody had to start somewhere. It's the Beatles. Were hired to play a birthday party one time in 1957. I think I always have to bring this story up if anybody wrenches Gene Cornish. I have pictures of him as a kid somewhere in my house because my mom played bingo with his mom.
Yeah.
And at a show at the House of Guitars, I talked to Gene. His mom had passed away, and I'm wondering if my mom's telling me a tall tale, right? So Gene says, go talk to that woman there. There's an elderly lady. And I mentioned my mom. He's like, yeah, we used to play bingo. So that's my 6th degree of separation to the Rascal.
Yeah. Oh, okay. They were a great band.
I have an oddball question.
Go ahead.
Is any of you guys, or do any of you guys, have any of the old wardrobes? The bell bottom, the Nehru shirt.
I have three pairs of Bob. Three Bob's bell boobo.
Actually, a follow up to that. When you see pictures of yourself in those clothes, what do you think?
You remember them white shirts that you and Al had with the big puffy sleeves?
Puffy shirts.
Oh, God.
Like Diva Las Vegas.
We used to go to New York, Greenwich Village, and at that time in the 60s, all the stuff was all over.
Sure. Right.
We'd pick different stuff. We'd go probably once a month, and that was part of our act too. Dressing, Nehru,
It was the fashion then.
We were poor. We went to Goldstein's.
Goldstein's had some good stuff.
Beansy's bargain.
We just had Beansy's for the military outfits.
Beansy's,
That was the greatest.
This is old school stuff, ladies and gentlemen. We're going way back.
What's happened that none of this is, why is it there isn't that anymore? People following bands around, there's nothing. Yeah. Nothing.
There's no place.
The rock and roll scene is gone.
It's a whole different, everything has changed. Just like, really, if you stop and think about it, all through the years, the fashions have changed, the music has changed. I mean, it went from, let's go back to, let's say, our parents' era, when it was Sinatra and Dean Martin, you know, the Rat Pack era. There was that music. Then the Beatles come along, the British Invasion, things are changing, and our parents are going, the hell is that?
Right.
You know? So, and again, then they get into the 70s, it was a whole different thing. You had Saturday Night Fever, and everybody was getting dressed up in their disco outfits. Yeah, so every generation has got a different thing.
Yeah,
I'm not buying into what's going on right now. I'm very old school. I hate to say it, but you know, I'm turning into my parents, I guess. Right?
I think the only thing for me was the '90s. When I liked the music of the '90s. But I didn't care. Like, the 80s, I liked, even though, you know, the big hair and all that. But people took time. They had an image, and they looked good. The 90s come along, everybody looks like they crawled out of a dumpster and went on stage. So,
sadly.
Ripped clothes and all. I mean,
T-shirts, sandals, Jesus sandals, you know. Man, I don't want to look at your toes while you're performing, man, you know. And if you're going to wear open-toed sandals, please shave your toes.
That's right. getting better now.
There's a little question, though. You know, you always hear about those long hairs also. You know where that comes from? It actually comes from World War One. If you go back to Victorian times, you would see men hair down to here.
Right.
But you would have short haircuts because of being in the trenches and lice and everything.
I noticed that.
So that's how this came along.
Okay.
And it stuck.
Yeah.
But I think there's an idea, too. You're using your voices as an instrument. You have to look good. Now it's like some guy we found outside here went on stage.
Yeah.
You know?
Right. Yeah.
We're very, very particular about everything like that.
Yeah.
I mean, there was no tuning up on stage. I was vehement about that.
I still hate that.
I hate that. So when you get on stage, one, two, three, boom.
Right.
We had lights. you know, it's really, we really took.
Sure.
You got to have a production.
We're professional looking.
We had spotlights. We had our own lights, our own sound system.
Uh-huh.
The clothes and all that stuff.
We had
we didn't have 5 minutes between songs.
No.
Right.
Yeah.
You finished, you go into another one.
Right.
Okay.
Yep.
How many songs did we have? Somebody asked me that.
Many.
I said, we had so many. We had to have close to 100 or whatever.
Really?
Okay. Yeah. Three sets a night.
Yeah.
Okay.
We went through about 40 songs a night.
Oh, yeah. At least that.
Holy crap.
I have one more story about Motown. I think it's interesting. Because the studio at Motown was very small. There was a board here, then two steps down there was a couch, and then the glass was right there where you could see the...
Yeah.
And Stevie Wonder was in there.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
I'm surprised he let me down there. So I was watching Stevie Wonder, and his girl at the time was named Serena.
Serena, yeah.
Now, he's in there on the microphone, and he had one mic here and one over here. He could put his nose here so he knew how far away from the mic, because he's blind, right?
Sure.
And I think he was doing signed, sealed, delivered.
Mm-hmm.
And he couldn't read the lyrics, obviously. So she would sing the lyrics in his earphones.
Wow.
He'd hear the track in his voice.
Mm.
And she'd sing... sign, sealed, delivered. He goes, sign, sealed, delivered. I'm yours.
Wow.
And then a couple times he got behind, and she'd say, I love you, baby. And he'd go, I love you, baby. And he'd get that.
Made
the whole thing sound like so original and everything.
Yep.
But I said, look at this guy.
Yeah, how about, creative, boy.
How about the day we saw Undisputed Truth recording Smiling Faces?
Oh, you know,
that guy with the
hat.
It blew my mind. It's so freaking beautiful, man.
Yeah. That is a good tune. I still like listening to that one today myself.
We were just standing there looking at this guy singing that song with that deep voice. It just blew my mind. That thing became such a big hit. I couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
What was that group that we saw in the aisleway that were practicing their moves? Do you remember that? Was that the Stylistics or the...
Oh, it could have been any one of them. Yeah. That's another thing. I'm glad you brought that up.
Yeah.
It was almost like, well, if you read Berry Gordy's story, it was like a factor. He worked at the Ford on the production line.
Right.
He made Motown like that. I mean, you'd go downstairs and there'd be one room where they're working out all their choreography. Wow. Then in the next room, there was a woman there that taught the young girls how to dress and how to talk and how to articulate.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And then there was another room where they dressed, learned how to dress. And they would, it would be Holland, Dozier, and Hollard would write the songs. The guys in the studio would play the tracks with the producer.
Right.
Then they'd take them downstairs, learn how to dance, how to dress, and out next.
Yeah.
I mean, well, he had a real, and it worked.
They took you under their wing, and they showed you the ropes. And
exactly.
Yeah, that's,
I still have that Motown contract with the letter that came with it from the wife of the Dozier guy, Holland. Her name was Holland.
Holland Dozier Holland.
Yeah, right. Well, she wrote the letters to all of us with the Motown wow. Contract included.
Oh, really?
Yes.
I don't even have that.
I still have mine.
Wow.
With the letter. Yeah.
Yeah, we got to get a copy of that. That's great.
I remember our Dean Taylor showing us the wooden block that they used for Baby, 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 that song by the Supremes, where they stepped on it.
Yeah, they go, baby, baby.
Oh, right.
They have about three guys on it.
Oh, right.
No kidding.
Yeah,
that's
they
cool.
kept that. They kept that at the
kind of like old radio
Pittsville.
Stuff.
Yeah.
So next time you hear that song, you listen to
we'll have to listen
that,
a little closer
didn't
next time.
Didn't they clap at the same time?
I think so. You know, we always get to the interesting stuff before the shows. Greg, weren't you talking about drums before the show?
Well, David and I were, yeah.
Was it anything with this, though?
Well, I mean, drums have changed so much. I mean, when you guys were playing, did you have single-headed toms and all that, or did you always have, you know, bottom heads and all
that? All of a sudden, everybody was taking the bottom heads off.
For a while,
the
everybody did the bottom heads, so I did, too. And it sounded like hell.
Yeah.
So I put them back up on again.
Yeah. Yeah, it was in vogue, and then I'm so glad it's gone. I hate that sound.
I hate that, because it's so hollow.
All the bass drums had, like, 50 pounds of pillows and blankets stuffed in there.
Microphone.
Yeah.
So I got a question here. You guys, I believe, David and I talked about this quite a while ago. David invited me over to his house several years ago, and it was funny. It was the first time I think we really connected and got to meet one another, and David says, why don't you come over to the house, listen to some tunes, maybe we'll play some drums a little bit, you know, and I was all excited. I said, man, here's a guy that I used to sit and watch and listen to, and, you know, he's inviting me over to his house. I thought that was really cool. But David told me that he had mentioned it to his wife, that I'm having a guest over. I'm bringing over this fellow that I just met, and your wife said something along the lines: Is he okay? Is this guy? Is he safe? Or what was your? Do you remember that? Do you remember your wife was
safe
a little
for what?
Your wife was a little concerned about me coming over. Maybe she heard something that I don't know.
You're a drug dealer. I don't know.
No, but then when she saw you, I can imagine.
His wife was worried about me coming over to visit.
Were you getting like notes with stuff cut out of magazines or something?
I have no idea. I don't remember that.
You don't remember that day?
No, but we had fun playing drums.
We had fun that day, man. We were jamming, man.
I'm really bad. Like, my short-term memory's horrible. I have too many things going on. But one of your songs that really affected me, I really enjoyed it, thought it was deep, was, I'm going to get the name a little wrong, We All End Up in Boxes.
Yeah.
That was like, it seemed like the era.
That was at the end of the Rush.
That was the end. That was the one to put it on the ground.
The band ended up in boxes. Yeah.
That was actually the Motown band.
Okay, the studio cats,
And this other producer, Mike Belvano, had Al and I go in and sing over this track.
Okay.
And unfortunately, that's a sad song.
It is. It's kind of a depressing
song. That's why it got me.
Depressing.
I think that's why it really got me, because, I mean, I know all these singer-songwriters. All I hear is Mel Gulley songs.
It's right up there with that blood rock song, DOA.
Oh, DOA, Dead on Arrival. That's nice. I got that album.
Running down my fingers. like Alice Cooper.
Well, did you do any Christmas songs just to lighten the mood?
I know, right? Everybody does a Christmas album. So how about this Jimi Hendrix thing that you guys did? Did you guys fill in for a band that didn't show at the Rochester War Memorial?
No, we were booked for that.
You were booked
yeah,
for that?
Because Ferdinand was running that show, I believe, and okay. he had us back him up. We were open the show for him. Yeah.
They had to be quite an experience, but...
of course, yeah, and we were able to get into their locker room, the dressing room.
Dressing room, yeah.
The setup man wouldn't let us in, but Jimmy said, "Let them in." Jimmy, step aside, let them in. Yeah. We all came in, three or four of us, and we took photographs of them.
Yeah, he was smart. He took photographs.
Yeah,
the rest of us
didn't. David gave me a picture with Jimmy.
Jim Gerber. Jake Gerber snuck in somewhere. The snake.
Yeah, that's awesome, man. Good foresight there.
Supposedly true or not, somebody would have to look it up. We don't look it up on the show. This is the only show at the War Memorial. It's the only show Hendrix didn't sell out on that tour.
Wow. Yeah. I missed that show, too. That was a weeknight, a school night, which usually didn't matter. I went to a lot of concerts, luckily enough, during the week and even on the weekends.
What would it have cost you, like $2?
Yeah, they weren't expensive back then.
Well, that time period, though, we were more of a top 40 town. Yeah. We weren't really into the rock and roll thing like we are now.
Well, I was lucky enough. I saw Janice. She was at the Eastman Theater. I saw The Doors, Eastman Theater.
Well, that would be a good venue to see both of those.
Yeah. Sadly, I missed Hendrix. It was a Thursday night. It was a school night, 1968.
Wow.
March, I believe it was March 21st, 1968. And Hendrix was here. And
you were.
Didn't he walk off the stage that day?
Those guys, yeah, they were drunk. Yeah, they were drinking gin in the locker room. Yeah. They had bottles of gin. And Mitchell took a bottle of gin right next to his drums.
Really?
Yeah, man. Yeah. This is the way those guys played. It blew my mind.
And he still played his tail off or what?
Of course.
You kidding me? The guy's amazing.
I think that's why they get drunk. I mean,
What about those guys from the Rock?
Miss Mitchell, yeah.
Yeah. They did Schools Out for the Summer. Remember them nuts?
Yeah, Schools Out for Summer. That was in New York.
Yeah, we were at the Rock.
Schools Out for Summer. Who's that been?
Alice Cooper.
Oh, Alice Cooper.
No.
I can't remember their name. They were out of control, completely. I couldn't believe it.
I wonder who that is. I have to look that
up. Was it in the bathroom?
Brownsville Station.
Brownsville Station. Oh, my God.
Yeah. We played with War. We played with Mountain. We played with a lot of things.
Yeah, we played
Mountain. That was an interesting one.
In the middle of nowhere.
In a mountain.
At the time, we were dressing in suits.
In the fields of work.
And we were playing right across from the Vagrants. There was Mountain. What's his name?
Leslie West.
Leslie West. And the drummer, Popolardo, was a bass player. He became famous, too. And the Vagrants, right? So we're dancing around with our suit jackets on. These guys come out looking like the Rolling Stones. And I remember the guy, the front man came out spinning a tambourine. He went, hum, and they had a chord. And I said, that's how you do it.
Right,
and then the suits went.
What about with Emerson, Lake, and Palmer? Remember when we opened up for them?
Oh, man, you guys really got around.
Scranton, Pennsylvania. They came down with that. I don't even know what it was. It was like that. They came running down the whole auditorium or the whole place.
The synthesizers, yeah.
Yeah, he had the synthesizer on him, and all you hear is.
Did he have like one of those guitar things, or was it just a synth?
No, it was just a small little stick, basically. Yeah, it was really wild.
We thought we had really great equipment. I mean, we had a lot of equipment. Yeah. And then they rolled it off stage, and they rolled their stuff in like two stories high.
Right.
And I was like, holy shit. What the
We were talking to him. We said, well, you know, you could use our equipment. No, that's okay. We have our own.
These big black speakers, they were so huge. I couldn't believe they were speakers. You know, they just rolled them out and they just took over. Procol Harum was there as well.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, man. Yeah. Life Shade of Bill, they just blew me away. Just a wonderful, wonderful show that was.
Yeah.
Yeah, the good old bands, man. All those bands really played, really had style, and they really had, I don't know, they had a plan. It wasn't just a bunch of tracks, and I don't know, things have just changed so horribly.
They had distinctive sounds, too.
Yeah. Right.
Very distinctive in the 60s.
especially with vocals. Yeah, you were the voice of the band, pretty much. You and Al.
Myself and Al, and actually Bob and
Ronnie.
And Ronnie used to sing really great harmonies. We really had a good harmony
sound.
Yeah,
right.
Because well, that was a big thing for me.
Ronnie had
singing.
That real high voice, man.
Oh yeah. He had all the real high stuff.
Yeah, having four voices in a six-piece band, that's a lot. That's great, you know, because you can do so much more.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And these guys laid down some heavy tracks. It was good.
When we were down in Long Island, we played with a group called Mandela, who later became
Vanilla Fudge. Mandela,
yeah. That's right.
They became Vanilla Fudge after that.
That was at on Long Island at that high school.
Yeah, that was... Yeah, we hung out there for a while. Long
I forgot the name of them. Because I remember we walked in and it would smell just like patchouli.
That's right.
The whole place smelled like, and I never smelled it.
But right. Their organs.
Oh, that's cool. Okay. Oh, yeah. That must have been part of their act, you know?
Yeah. Burning sage. Yeah.
Oh, I read Carmen Appice's book and everything. I had to wash my hands after reading it in the Rock and Roll Life.
So at the end of the Rustix run, it was when I was just starting up in the early 70s, early to mid-70s.
Right.
So we put together a band that eventually became a band called Circus. And we actually were going to fashion ourselves, because we admired you guys so much, we were going to have two singers, which didn't quite work out that way. And we ended up with just one lead singer, but that's okay. But the Bedlam album, once again, was very impressive to a lot of us back then. So we took the arrangement that you guys, what the Rustix did to, I heard it through the grapevine, how it starts out with the, bass player and the drums and that rhythm leading into the song. So we copied your version of it and we played it. And I used to get a really thrill. Bobby DeAndre used to come and see us every now and then. We were playing at the Centurion on Goodman Street.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then somebody would say, it was
Centurion.
Wow. Doing a good job on this thing, Bobby. Bobby DeAndre is in the audience tonight.
The 70s club, that's
why. But,
he's a great guy, Bobby.
Yeah.
Centurion. Where on Goodman Street was
right
that?
Right across from Bausch & Lomb.
I remember that. I knew the guys who ran that.
The old United Dairy. Remember the United Dairy?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It was right next door to that. It kind of set back a little bit. It was the Hi-Fi Lounge before it was the Centurion.
Yeah, okay. You guys didn't know it either when they brought it up before. I never heard of it myself.
The Centurion?
I used to go there. I used to hear this band, Hurricane.
St. Paul.
Hurricane.
Who were the brothers there? I knew both of them.
St. Paul? I don't remember.
Yeah, right at the end of my song.
I mean... We used to play the Living Room Lounge, King's Lounge. Remember that?
Oh,
we used to
living room.
Living room, yeah.
Carter and Norton.
Carter Street.
All the boys used to
play. Yeah, and I played there. Yeah. I used to play there with that Subway band, and we used to go hear the band that David Accorso was in, the three-piece thing, or the duo, whatever they had, that trio they had.
Oh, was that what was it?
Wizard?
It was Wizard.
Yeah.
But didn't they also play with the guy out of Detroit, Denny? Geez, I forgot his last name.
But I remember David Corso, man. I used to just sit there and watch.
Oh, David was great. David was great. Yeah.
Well, and Mike Pagano. That
how about anybody here ever play at the Tiny's Bengal Inn? Let's go back to the 60s, man.
Yeah.
That was a great place to play. Man.
I've heard a lot about it.
Love playing there, man.
Yeah, you guys
played there with the Invictus and the Playboys.
It's such a cool name for a bar.
Tiny's Bengal.
The airport. That was
the airport.
Yeah.
That was an old rock club. Yeah. Wow.
How about the Hall of Fame inductions? How did you guys... I mean, it must have been quite an honor, obviously, and a thrill for you guys to be inducted into the Rochester Music Hall of Fame.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
I know a lot of guys who want that trophy. I'll tell you.
What year was that? Al missed that.
Yeah,
Al.
Was it 2016? 2016,
yeah.
I think.
Wow, congratulations. Yeah. That's awesome.
You didn't know?
Really? It's an honor to have that trophy.
The big thing was being on stage at the Eastman Theater.
Yeah, that
meant a lot to me. So many people have been on that stage.
Yeah, we were on there before.
Yeah.
We played a gig there early on.
I was there.
Brown jackets, brown suits.
Oh yeah,
I was there for the induction.
That was a good color.
I always think it's cool too when your work's appreciated.
Was the bass player then.
So Vinny, quick question for you.
Sure.
So how has the change in keyboard gear affected you, or if it does?
Truthfully, some of the new ones, I'm like lost.
Yeah.
If you want to know the truth, I would rather just have a little piano or, you know, something with keys that are
right. B3. There's so many patches.
Yeah. Or B3.
I mean, we were talking to, we had Rich Bialiso on the show a couple times. He said that he bought this keyboard, and it came with a manual of 160 pages or something. But he said it didn't really tell him anything. He went online and downloaded a 200-and-something page manual.
Yep.
And he learned a lot from that. But obviously, they don't tell you everything unless you go looking for it.
No, they don't anymore.
It's crazy. Yeah. You can layer sounds, split sounds, do all this stuff.
Yeah. You know who's a wizard is Andy.
Andy's the Calibre. Best, yeah.
He's really
good.
Yeah, I agree with that.
He
Andy,
makes us
Andy
sound
knows
good
his
every
way
week.
Around him.
Yeah.
So I had a memory that has stayed with me since 1969. November of 1969 was a tough month for me and my family. Where November 2nd, my dad passed away.
Oh, that's too bad.
And there was an upcoming concert at Eastridge High School with the Rustix. And so, you know, I bought tickets for myself and my girlfriend.
$2
to get in.
$2.
Got a ticket.
Yeah.
Dave sent me a picture of the ticket.
Have you got the Eastridge ticket?
Yes.
Come on. Come on. Really?
I think it's Carl Mooney. Yeah.
It might be
well,
Cardinal
I got to get a copy of that somehow. Yeah. Anyway, even a picture of it would be nice.
Yeah.
So it was a tough month. You know, my dad passed away, and... the concert was, I think, right around the end of the month, right after Thanksgiving. But sadly, another tragedy struck. My girlfriend's grandmother died on Thanksgiving at the dinner table.
Oh God!
And So nice. we had a terrible month that month. And so I remember, well, we got the tickets for the concert. And I said, well, you know, in all honesty, I said, we're not going to go to the show. I said, your grandmother just died. So her mother actually, David's showing me on his phone right. He's got.
Oh, wow, the Rustix.
This is Cardinal Mooney.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's probably the same price for you guys, too.
$2.
$2 to get in.
Here, we'll show it to everybody. Do a zoom in on this with the camera, ladies. Oh, wait a minute. There's no camera. Okay.
But that's great, though. You have all this stuff.
So, you know, I said to the girlfriend and her mom, we were talking, her mom insisted that we go to the Eastridge gig. And so we did. We went. And I remember standing next to the stage. It was at the Eastridge High School Gymnasium. And I remember standing next to the stage and just idolizing David over there and playing his drums and watching his foot. Okay, so that was my memory of
you know, I
of
remember
that
him doing
that
too.
Everybody was watching David.
The duty tracks.
I have one memory.
Give me a clean track.
We were playing in Springfield, Massachusetts at some club, and then we had to do that. That television thing up in Quebec, and we pull into that the airport, and they got a little jet for us, a little Learjet.
Wow!
And of course, it's 5-seater, more or less.
Okay.
And these guys forced me to sit in the front with the pilot.
Oh boy!
Oh God!
Yeah.
Bird's eye view.
Oh yeah, it was all over the place.
No kidding.
Yeah, a lot of fun. Oh, pilot said, "Well, we got a crosswind. Yeah. You know, we had a land." He said, "We got a crosswind, pretty bad one." I said, "Well, do you ever land in that?" He went, "No, but it'll be okay." That
very
plane
confident.
Was all over.
Oh, Chuck, you know, I would be remiss if we didn't. How did you get into jingles?
Fear of poverty.
Excellent.
No, I've always liked writing. Even when I was a kid, I used to just like to write stuff, make up things like that, and... when I started working with Jay Advertising, with Ferd, when he started his agency, he says, "Why don't you start writing some jingles?" I says, "All right." And we started there, and worked for 8 years with Ferd, and we finally did the CBS Movie of the Week theme, which was a big deal.
Wow.
And after that, I went on my own. I just wanted to do my own thing.
There's a story I like to tell from Cliff Eberhart, where he talks about one gig I was at. He goes, hear the Burger King thing? That's me. Hear the Chevy thing? That's me. And people go, how do you do that? You're a folk singer. He goes, yes, I'm a folk singer. A folk singer who owns a house.
I'd also like to bring up another memory, too. Maybe you guys remember this one. This was a huge, huge event. I believe it was a Sunday afternoon in, where was this place? Vince's 50 Acres on West Henrietta Road.
Right.
And I believe there were four bands. I think you have an article. I saw the article, David, on your wall. Mm-hmm. David saves a lot of the old memories.
Get all the good stuff.
Yeah. Vince's 50 Acres. And, of course, the Rustix played. Was it Wilmer and the Dukes?
Wilmer and the Dukes.
The
Brass Buttons.
And the Showcase, and I believe. The Showcase. I think they were the fourth band.
It was the house.
Was it the house?
Yeah. The house, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So, must have been a good one.
It was a good one.
The best
you were
bands,
there.
Man.
I was.
You were there. It was a good one.
Well, it was a 60s band.
It had to be a good one. I don't remember any of it.
I was there.
But, you know, like every kid in the city of Rochester, every high school kid was there. I mean, that was a huge, huge building.
Yeah, it was.
You know? And I've always remembered that show. It was such a great event, having all these bands, all the Rochester's top bands, all in one place on one day.
That was great.
Well, they used to do that, you know, in the 50s, they had those package tours with the rock bands.
Sure.
But
this was all the local bands. Were you there?
But that's cool. No, but I'm just saying, even that booking approach has changed a little bit, unless you're at a festival.
They're starting to do it a little bit now. You see a lot of top, two big names, three big names are trying to give you your money's worth, because to see a show today is going to cost you $100 to $200 or more, depending on who's on the bill. They're getting expensive.
Yeah, speaking of that, the Stones just started their tour.
You got to take out a small business loan to go see some.
You were just mentioning Logan's. That always hits with me because I've seen so many of my friends get married there.
Yeah, we played there once.
Logan's?
Yeah.
With
same thing.
It's not Scottsville.
With a group of other bands.
All these party houses are gone today. I don't know.
You remember the Maple Ward, D'Andrea's?
The Maplewood.
I've done some New Year's Eve's at the Maple Ward.
D'Andrea's is gone. They're all gone.
Doesn't anybody dance anymore?
Where are people getting married?
People party at home.
Where do they dance? I mean, people went out to dance. There's no place like that anymore.
I know.
They do, but the problem is the dance floors are very small.
So
And the places are small. A lot of bands can't even play in most of the bars anymore.
It's the restaurants as well,
So there's really no place for a band or bands to play where you can get a lot of people, have a bar in there, and then a big dance
to make it profitable.
Yeah. Well, it's always been said that the bands are always the afterthought when it comes to entertainment in a bar.
Yeah.
You know, they say, where are we setting up? I'm here. I'm with the band. Yeah, you'll see that little closet over there? Put the drums in the closet. Yeah,
they tell the contractor, make a little triangle in the corner, and it'll get up there.
We always make it work, though.
Yeah.
Somehow we always make it work. Yeah. Never missed a gig. I've never missed a gig. All these years later, I've never came close when I had my DJ service going out in the mid-'80s. And one of the guys that I worked with at Kodak booked me for a party, and it was a blizzard. It was out in Canandaigua somewhere. Man, I'm driving in a snowstorm.
Right.
Okay, and this is way before your computers on your phone would give you the directions.
Tell them about
Do you have any good horror stories about driving in the weather? Any of you?
I could have four monkeys up on the stage.
I decided to turn around and go home for that gig because I couldn't find the place in the snowstorm.
You guys have any brutal weather stories?
I turned around, but I ran right into the party house. I was lucky and got set up, and I did the gig.
Wow. Yeah.
Then you reminded me of the story we had. Where was this place? In Pennsylvania?
The home of the mushroom capital. So
on Monday, Tuesday, through the week was kind of light, and we had a lot of go-go dancers or strippers come in and warm up, and then they'd leave.
Right.
Now, Friday night comes, and there was this old Italian woman at the door, and we had a good crowd on Friday night, and I went up to her, and I said, right. Mrs. So-and-so, we got a nice crowd here tonight. She goes, on a Friday night, we could have a Three Monkeys up there. Oh, thanks a lot.
Three Monkeys.
That was nice.
Thanks for that.
Vote of confidence.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Oh, man.
I remember playing at Kirkwood, New York.
Boy, you got a memory.
Yeah, and that was that. And it was like a barn. It was just a steel barn.
Oh, yeah?
And we got there, and it was like in the wintertime. And we started thinking, well, how many people can be coming? And the whole place was jammed up.
Yeah.
What we figured out after a while is the people from Pennsylvania were coming up because it was 21 years old to drink in Pennsylvania and only 18 in New York State. Oh. And this was like right on the border.
Right on the border.
A mile away from the border.
Oh.
So that place was all jammed up.
Well, see, that partially killed things, too, when they switched the ages around.
That's right.
Yep.
You know, 19 wasn't so bad, but when they jumped it to 21, everything got weird.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that's probably what killed a lot of that band and nightclub stuff.
Sure, it did.
I mean, some of us were lucky. We kind of made it through both, but, you know, I felt bad. 21's a long time to ask kids to, and then they're going to just start doing more dumb things because, I mean, you're practically married by the time you're 21.
You can serve in the military, but you can't have a drink.
Yeah, I know.
But a friend of mine said you can get married, but I can't have a beer at my wedding.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
Well, things have changed. Everything is one-night gigs now, where it used to be, could be four, five, six nights. Yep. The Centurion, in the beginning, that was our first gig that Vic Carroll booked us at.
Vic Carroll. Tony Carroll.
Okay, yeah. And he came to my house and booked Circus and gave us our start. 2 weeks, six nights each week. I think the Mondays they were closed. So we played Tuesday through Sunday. You know, you'd leave your equipment there, and you're all ready to go the next night.
You get pretty tight playing those.
Yeah, that's for sure.
I remember going with the whole bunch of us going to see Lou Graham over at that little club right on Dewey Avenue.
Oh, that was...
right by Ridge Road.
Oh, yeah. I know where
that is. What's the name of the monkey?
It was like...
The Brass Rail. That's the Brass Rail.
Very good.
In the front of the Kodak parking lot?
This was on Dewey Avenue, right?
Right, yeah, it wasn't the Brass Rail.
Oh, wasn't the
Brass Rail? I can't think of the name of the place.
Okay. It was like a little house.
There was really nothing to it. It's still there.
Is it?
But it's not a club or anything.
Okay.
And there's like a little roadway to turn into Kodak parking lot, but right next to it was this
brown
building.
Oh, I know what you're talking
about,
yeah.
Was that where they had the three singers in their band?
It might have been, yeah. I think
they were very good. I heard them one night.
Yeah.
What was the band?
Three singers? Three female singers?
No, they had Lou Graham's original.
Black Sheep.
Poor Heart.
Poor Heart. They were very good.
Yeah, I saw them at high school.
That's when his brother was playing the drums. Was Benny?
Benny was playing drums. Benny. Yeah, they had great vocals.
He's very talented, too.
Yep.
Yeah, that was a good man. Lou's got a great voice.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
I mean, he got the brass ring for sure. So.
That's right.
Yeah, he did. No doubt.
Still making money, dude. Still making money on that song.
Yep, I know.
This has been, I have to say.
You always will.
This has been very cool. And I think what it does, too, is it points to the power of music. Because I can't remember yesterday, but look at all of us saying, like, decades ago, I remember that show.
Yeah. Well, these guys were a big influence on me, honestly. You know, it has been a thrill for me to get to know each one of these fellas over the years. I think I'd like to consider them good friends now, and I really appreciate them showing up today and be with us. They took time out of their personal life to be here with us today and share some of the stories. So I want to thank you guys so much.
Really,
thanks for having
you guys.
Really.
Hey, can I have $5?
I mean, yes, we did our usual, as we do on the show, where we stick them in the middle so they can't flee when they leave the
We box them in.
We always have to do
they're
that.
They're stuck in the
but
middle.
It's been great, though.
This has been great.
And what's everybody doing now? Just enjoying life? Or
you're buying us breakfast. Or lunch now. It's later in the day here, so. Forgot to tell you about that.
No, what have you guys been up
anything,
to? Though,
anything, just enjoying your life, quiet life?
Well, I'm doing my jingle thing and playing with my grandson and doing a little golfing and that kind of thing.
Sounds good.
Yeah. I'm enjoying it.
Where do you play?
Everywhere.
Oh, see, I actually went, I had golf for years. My buddy Sean retired. He's like, let's go to Island Valley. So bad.
Oh, yeah, that was a small one. That's when I first started. I was hitting every bush.
My parents used to go there for New Year's Eve parties. Yeah. But I didn't golf for a while. I, like, whipped four times before I hit the ball.
Yeah, it sounds like me. Yeah. I just like being out there. I'm not that good. Yeah.
That's what it is. You're relaxed. It's nice out.
How about the rest of you guys? You playing a little
bit? I'm a painter. I create artwork. I went to school after the Rustix. Went to art school for nine years. Yeah, became a teacher for 25 years.
Sweet.
And then I retired from that. And I paint full time. That's what I do. I create artworks by the week, and I put them on Facebook.
Wow.
And I show at Michael's Valley Grill, Benfield.
Yeah, yeah.
The fine dining restaurant, and I decorate the place with all my about 35
really
pieces.
Where
every 6 months I change them out. Yeah, so.
Oh, Michael's, have to stop in there and look at that.
Stop in there, please. Yeah.
Yeah.
I got paintings of all these musicians that I've painted over the years there. You know.
Have
you?
I give you credit for being a teacher, but I took music ed at Nazareth, and I subbed for a year or so, and I was like, ew, this is not for me. I give you a lot of credit.
Well,
it's a hard job.
And I'm like semi-retired.
Yeah.
I do some electrical work, and I do some teaching, electrical, and basically trying to enjoy life as much as I can.
Mm-hmm. Get a trade. Kids, get a trade. Remember, you can't all be computer programmers. Okay.
And these keyboards are complex these days if you think of going into that. But does anybody have anything from the phone to play at the end? Or are we not going to play a song or anything?
Oh, you know, I forgot to bring. I did toilet. Something.
We can get one on YouTube if anybody wants to pick something out.
We should have never done that, man. Flush the toilet. Album, that really killed it.
The toilet flushing.
Oh, yeah. That was one of my great ideas.
Yeah. Maybe that's where the album should go.
What song was that?
Because every night we used to end with Happy Trails.
Yeah, Happy Trails.
They sang Happy Trails. Trails at the end of the second album.
We'll confer and we'll pick a surprise Rustix song to play for you. So make sure you stay tuned. It won't have toilet flushing.
It was my mistake. I didn't bring. I've got both albums on CDs, and of course I forgot them at home.
Oh, and by the way, if we want your albums or CDs, are they available? Can we get them?
The LPs are available.
I think the House of Guitars has some.
Yeah, well, I've got the LPs, online. But I'd like the CDs.
I've got ten of the Bedlam albums for sale. So anybody needs them.
You're the guy that stole the 10 albums.
Yeah. Actually, they're out there. You can find them, and when I see them, and they're affordable. That I buy them, you know.
Right.
I mean, if you need one or you need 10, I got them.
And on that, after talking about the black market album sales, we always have a little problem ending the show. So thank you very much, gentlemen. I really appreciate
it.
Yeah.
Yep.
So it's really good.
Thanks for having us. Yeah.
Let's give them a round of applause, everybody.
Yeah. The Rustix.
The Rustix, ladies and gentlemen.
Is smiling on till then.
Okay, cool. That was awesome, guys.
seems to be safe.